Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our service on this beautiful day after a slightly damp one yesterday, I think it was. As you've no doubt gathered, Paul is away having a few days' break, and hopefully you've had the notices by email. If you haven't had the notices by email and want to know what's going on, there is a copy at the back of church. Please get one before you go out. The service this evening, including communion, is going to be led by our friend Neil, Reverend Neil Kirkham, who I think most of us know quite well now, because he's been leading us very successfully in worship for quite a few times now, Neil.
Well,
so without further ado, I'll hand you over to Neil.
Thank you very much indeed for your warm welcome. I was beginning to wonder what they meant by Sonny Rill. It is occasionally. Let's worship God. From Psalm 41. Blessed is he who has regard for the weak. The Lord delivers him in times of trouble. The Lord will protect him and preserve his life. He will bless him in the land and not surrender him to the desire of his foes. The Lord will sustain him on his sickbed and restore him from his bed of illness. Let's pray. Father God, as we come to gather around your table, we're very conscious of our own weaknesses. We know our vulnerabilities. We know how easily tempted we are. We know how despondent we can become in spite of your faithfulness, in spite of your love and your presence and your strength to help us, because so often we forget. Jesus' command was to remember. We come to remember all that you have done for us, all that you mean to us, your wonderful salvation in Jesus Christ, the outpouring of your Holy Spirit to live in us and through us, to guide us, remind us, strengthen us. So, Father, we come to worship. We can do no other but bow down humbly before your throne. And as we gather, we pray together the family prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, and save those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our first hymn this evening is number 649, are the words are on the screen. The King of Love, my Shepherd is, whose goodness faileth never. Thank you. Tony is going to come and read to us from God's Word.
Our first reading this evening is from Isaiah chapter 58, verses 1 to 12, True Fasting. Shout it aloud, do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion, and to the descendants of Jacob their sins. For day after day they seek me out. They seem eager to know my ways, as if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commandments of God. They ask me for decisions and seem eager for God to come near them. Why have we fasted, they say, and have you not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves, and have you not noticed? Yet on the day of your fasting, you do as you please and exploit all your workers. Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife, and in striking each other with wicked fists. You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. If this, the king of fast I have chosen, only a day for people to humble themselves, is it only for bowing one's head like a reed, or for lying in sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is it not this the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, Here I am. If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like a noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose water never fails. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins and will raise up the age-old foundations. You will be called the repairer of broken walls, restorer of streets and dwellings. The second reading is from Galatians chapter 2, verses 6 to 10. As for those who were held in high esteem, whatever they were makes no difference to me. God does not show favoritism. They added nothing to my message. On the contrary, they recognized that I had been entrusted with the task of preaching the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been to the circumcised. For God, who was at work in Peter as an apostle to the circumcised, was also at work in me as an apostle to the Gentiles. James, Cephas, and John, those esteemed as pillars, gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles, and they to be the circumcised. And they asked, was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing I had been eager to do all along. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for those readings from God's Word. Let's sing again, 806. Wonderful Graham Kendrick hymn, Beauty for Brokenness, Hope for Despair. Lord, in your suffering world, this is our prayer. Of thanks to our organist this evening. She did say to me that I don't make it easy for her in the hymns that I choose, but she did brilliantly well, didn't she?
Thank you.
A few months ago, Pam and I were resting one Sunday afternoon, one wet and cold winter's afternoon, and what should be on the television but J.B. Priestley's An Inspector Calls. Who's seen it? A spoiler alert for those who haven't. It's the story of a rich family. And one day, a police inspector calls out of the blue to tell them of a young girl who's just taken her life by drinking a bottle of disinfectant. And he goes through each member of the family because he says, you know her. It turns out that this young girl was one of the poor workers who had worked in the father's factory. And she'd had the temerity to question some of the working conditions under which people labored, for which she was rewarded with the sack. She went and got another job in a ladies' outfitters. And one day, the mother and the daughter in the family went there to pick a dress for the daughter. The daughter was in a foul mood, couldn't find what she wanted, and blamed the young shop assistant, for which she was sacked. The elder son had met this young girl and had taken advantage of her sexually. Another brother had taken advantage of her, but he was the only one in the family who had actually any sympathy with her whatsoever. And it all came back to them. And then the inspector left them to ponder. And the father decides to ring up the police station, and he discovers, no, we've had no such girl brought in here. We know nothing about this. Phew, says the father, we're off the hook, and they just go back to normal. Except for the young lad. The young lad knows who they're talking about, and he's concerned for her, and he's just about to leave when the phone rings. This is the police station here. We've just had a young girl brought in who's taken her own life by drinking disinfectant. It just shows the attitude of the times where those who were rich and privileged had no thought for the poor. They simply used them and took advantage of them. There's a verse in the hymn, All Things Bright and Beautiful. We don't sing it anymore. It used to have about 9 verses. But it talks about the rich man in his castle, the poor man at his gate, and goes on to say that God gave them each their estate. Basically, God ordained some to be rich, some to be poor, and don't interfere with it. That's the way it's meant to be. And that was so often in Victorian times, the attitude. We're living in days where the cost of living is rising, inflation reached double figures, it's falling slightly now. Fuel prices have gone up primarily because of the war in Ukraine. But the gap between the rich and the poor is rising and accelerating. The survey conducted since 2015 shows that the rich in Britain are 64% richer and the poor are 59% poorer. That's why the Welsh Assembly set up Communities First. And I know you all think of Llandudno as a posh Victorian queen of resorts. But there are 3 electoral wards in Llandudno that attracted Community First funding. Llandudno had the highest incidence of child poverty for a town of its size right across Wales. Doesn't compare with Cardiff and Swansea and the big cities, but of its size, it had the highest incidence of child poverty. Do we care? The answer is we should. God has given us a mandate throughout Scripture. Throughout the Old Testament, we are commanded to look after the widow and the orphan, those who have no one else to provide for them. In the law, there is this wonderful concept of the Jubilee, the year of Jubilee, way ahead of its time. It was revived in the millennium at 2000 to write off the debts of poorer nations, because somebody realized that actually the poorer nations give more to the rich than the rich give to the poor, which is crazy. But this is a situation where the year of Jubilee was every 7 years. So if through some unfortunate circumstances you found yourself in debt, you could sign over the rights to the land or the rights to your services, but you were renting the land and renting yourself out. In the year of Jubilee, it had to revert back to you. And it stops the downward spiral of poverty that so often exists. Once you get into debt, it's very difficult to get out of it. Once you go on an electric or gas meter, you pay more for your gas and electricity instead of less, which is crazy. If you buy things out of a catalogue, you pay twice as much for them as anybody else. You buy things that are cheap, but of course they don't last. You have to replace them. It's a downward spiral. The year of Jubilee was to reverse that. And in Isaiah, it challenges us. If you look after these people, if you do all of these things, if you care for the hungry and the poor and the naked and all those who are vulnerable, then you will call and the Lord will answer. Then your light will break forth like the dawn and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then people will sit up and take notice of Christ's church. If we do these things. If we move on to the New Testament, of course, Jesus pays attention to the blind, the crippled, the leper, the marginalized, those people who are possessed. He restores life so that they can join in society and begin to make their contribution to the well-being of all. It's not just a free handout to be enjoyed and sit back and do nothing. In Matthew 28, Jesus talks about judgment, the sheep and the goats, separated, one on his right, one on his left. And it's all to do with how you have responded to the needs of the hungry, the thirsty, those in prison, those who are sick. Because whatever you've done to them or for them, you have done for me. That's how we show our love for Christ, our appreciation of what Christ has done for us, by what we do for others, by passing it on. When the rich young man comes to him and says, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Love your neighbor as you love yourself." "Ah, yeah, but who is my neighbor?" And of course, Jesus tells the story of the Good Samaritan. It's the one who helped a man in need, no matter that they were your enemies, no matter that they were considered a different nation, excluded from Israel, no matter that generally they hated each other's guts. You do it because he was in need. Jesus is challenging the Pharisees about the way they pray, all their flowery prayers on the street corners, and when they give, you know, they make a great big show of it. And Jesus challenges them, and he says to them, when you give to the poor, not if, when you give to the poor, don't make a big show of it. Don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing. If we move on to the days of the early church, in chapter 4, it paints a picture of a church where the people who had land would sell it and bring it and pool the money, and it was distributed according to how people had a need. There was nobody in need amongst them. This is real community. And I know people will say, ooh, that sounds awfully like communism to me. The difference is that communism tries to do it without God. It tries to do it by forcing people to do these things. God is saying, you should be so full of the joys of life, so full of God's Holy Spirit, that you just want to do this. It's your deepest desire. In chapter 6, they attended to the needs of the widows. When there was a complaint, they appointed 7 men filled with the Holy Spirit, people like Stephen and Philip. That was just to distribute the money. And so we come to Paul. Paul goes out in his mission to the Gentiles. And he's followed round by a group called the Judaizers. They wanted to follow Christ, but they wanted to insist that people needed to become Jews first, and then they could follow Christ. You need to sign up to the law first. You need to be circumcised first, and then we'll let you in. And Paul is saying, I want to get away from this legalism. I want to get to a place where people are living by the Spirit within them. That you're not having to make people do these things. That the Spirit of God in them prompts them to show love to the weak and the vulnerable. And so he goes back to the church in Jerusalem to get a ruling on this matter. So he goes to James, the brother of Jesus, who's the head of the Jerusalem church, and Peter and John, and explains the situation. He says what God is doing through them amongst the Gentiles. And they're happy with that. You're doing a good work. Keep doing it. And Paul writes, the only thing they commanded was that I should pay attention to the needs of the poor, which is what I wanted to do in the first place. He was already doing it. Whenever he went round and there'd been famine in one area, he would take collections amongst the churches where there wasn't famine, and he or others of the disciples would deliver it to the areas where it was most in need. We can think about the story of Dorcas, who was celebrated because of her practical gifts, making clothes, feeding the poor. And through Peter, God raises her back to life. I could go on giving you loads of lists of examples. I want to make it clear that these people are not trying to earn their salvation. It's because they know they are saved. It's in gratitude to what Jesus has done for them. It's an evidence of the faith that is in them, their trust in a God who will provide for all my needs if I share it. And it's not just care for the poor, it's care for the whole of God's creation. One thing that's become clear with climate change is that it's the poor and vulnerable countries like Bangladesh and Africa and Kenya and places like this, the people who contribute least to global warming, who are suffering the most with the loss of crops. If we went on to church history, we are a product of the Methodist movement of the 18th century, where Anglicans, fed up with the formality and the intellectualism of the Church of England, went out into the streets preaching to the poor, making the gospel relevant to them, saying, look, there's a place for you within this church. So they took it from being the preserve of the squires and the nobility and the landed gentry and the intellectuals of the established church, and they took it to poor people. People who were poor, people who were uneducated. Notice I say uneducated, not unintelligent. They simply had never been given an education to use their intelligence. They made it understandable for them. Historians will tell you that it is generally reckoned that that Methodist revival of the 18th century is what prevented Britain from going through the same experiences that they did in the French Revolution. Otherwise, it would have happened here. Because that's what happens when the gap between rich and poor gets too big. When the poor are backed into a corner and they have no hope. When they're faced with their own poverty and they see others squandering God's resources, wasting them on trivia. That's when they start to take matters into their own hand. That's when you get revolution. We could go on to talk about Spurgeon, the Salvation Army, the Welsh Revival, the difference that it made amongst ordinary people. What do we mean by the poor? There are two definitions of poor. There is absolute poverty. This is where people have nothing to their name but the clothes they stand in, and they don't know where their next meal is coming from. There is nothing that they can do for themselves because they don't have the resources, the wherewithal, the health, the strength to do anything about it. There is little absolute poverty in Britain. But there are people who have to make difficult decisions between heating and eating. I know people who've had to make those decisions. But more common is relative poverty. It's where you define poverty relative to the average income within a nation. There is a wonderful book, A Church for the Poor, written by Martin Charlesworth and Natalie Williams, and they define relative poverty as the inability to access basic necessities to live viably in the UK or to play a normal part in our society. And amongst the things that are generally reckoned to be necessary, heating to keep a home adequately warm, a damp-free home, 2 meals a day, not 3, 2 meals a day. The ability to visit friends or family in hospital. The ability to replace or repair broken goods. Fresh fruit and vegetables every day. The opportunity to celebrate on special occasions, dental treatment, a warm waterproof coat. I could go on. There's a long list that people reckon are things which are necessary in this country. And I know often people will say to me, surely everybody in Britain has enough. Surely everybody in Britain has everything that they need compared to Africa. What we have to remember, of course, that the cost of living is a lot higher here. You cannot sleep in the winters outdoors as you can in some African countries. But the gap between rich and poor is critical. I had the privilege when I was working for McAlpines of traveling to Malawi. It's known as the warm heart of Africa. A really contented people. It's mainly because they have no mineral resources, so nobody from Europe invaded them because there was nothing to steal. They were a British protectorate, but the British rarely interfered because they had nothing that Britain needed. They're a contented people. I'm going back 40 years to a time when climate change hadn't begun to take effect. Everybody had a little plot of land. Nobody was rich, but they could grow enough food. And I have never met a more contented people in my life. Because nobody was rolling in it. They were all in the same boat. And they looked out for each other. Here in this country, we are surrounded by the media that tell us of the multi-million pound bonuses that bankers have been paid, the salaries that footballers get, more in 1 week than they will ever see in a lifetime. They're constantly bombarded by advertising that tells them that they're inadequate if they don't have this particular product. The children have peer pressure at school. They get mocked and laughed at if they don't have designer clothes. And the parents, wanting to care for their children, will go out and buy designer clothes so that they won't be laughed at. They don't have the money, so they'll get it through a catalogue. They'll pay 2-3 times as much. They will get themselves in debt, and then people like Wonga will be on their doorstep offering them loans at 150% interest. You see how the spiral works. We say that we should care for the poor for the sake of the poor. I told you something about the consequences if that gap gets too big. It had dire consequences for Marie Antoinette. It's not just about helping the poor, it's also about the security of the rich. So many rich people live in houses with high walls, with razor barb fence, with turrets, with armed guards on, with steel shutters on the doors, and you look at it and think, eee, that's a posh prison. That's where they live. Because they have to, because they're so afraid of losing what they've got. If the poorest person in Britain has everything that they need, how can I justify having 100 times as much? What people are telling me is I actually only need 1% of what I have. John Wesley, when he began preaching, was paid £1 a year. Wow, £1 a year. He could live, provide for his basic needs, for 19 shillings and sixpence a year. So he gave the sixpence away. as he became more famous and he got more engagements and things began to take off, he got to a salary of £5 a year. Inflation was zero, so he could still live on 19 shillings and sixpence. So he gave away £4 and sixpence. He kept only what he needed. He trusted in God. Now, there are different types of poverty. We've talked mainly about finances, but it's not just about finances. There is aspirational poverty, the loss of hope. You imagine Israel in exile, conquered by a foreign nation, an all-powerful nation. Will we ever see our homeland again? Will God be angry with us forever? And God sends a prophet amongst them with a message of hope. It's not always going to be like this. There is restoration. We have a forward movement church in Carnarvon on the Skibber Goch estate. On the Skibber Goch estate, they are into the third and fourth generation of unemployed. If the young people are fortunate enough to get an interview and they fill out an application form, the moment they put their address, things go very quiet. Nobody will employ anybody off the Skibber Goch estate because it has a reputation. It's this downward spiral. So the kids give up hope. Nobody's ever going to employ me. I'm never going to get anywhere. I'm never going to make anything of my life. What am I going to do with my time? The proverb is true, isn't it? The devil makes work for idle hands. They find other things to do, which just reinforces the reputation. Part of the work of Communities First was encouraging these youngsters, helping them to write CVs, setting up job clubs. People like Crest and Kais run social enterprises whereby they try to get these young people back into work. Our daughter, Hannah, worked for North Wales Training. That was their role. When she got married and went to Northampton, she worked in Wellingborough doing the same thing, trying to build these young people up, convincing them that you are somebody, you have something to contribute. God has a purpose in your life. Don't write yourself off. And then there's relational poverty, the loss of community. Poor people are very good at looking out for each other. What's mine is yours. The problem is what's mine is very little, but you're welcome to share it. They look out for each other. But they become isolated from the rest of society because they get put on estates of similar housing. They get put in hostels. It's all gathered together. Financial problems, of course, are one of the biggest sources of marital breakdown, so the families break down, so they find themselves even more isolated. There is a sense of failure to provide for their families, which leads to mental health problems. 40 years ago, when there was little work around, we were told to get on our bikes. People did. Social mobility is a big thing now. People go wherever the work is, but that takes them away from their families. Gone are the days when you got married and moved into the house next door, and so you had ready-made family on the doorstep. Babysitters, people to help out, support. They find themselves isolated. And they find themselves isolated from church because the church is seen as middle class. I don't want to go to church. I wouldn't fit in. They're all posh. And then there's spiritual poverty. I don't need to remind you about the decline of the church, but it's particularly true amongst the poor. And if you have no access to material comforts, that's when you need something deeper. Something that will give meaning and significance to your life. Something that will teach you that somewhere there is a God who loves you. Somebody cares about you. The gospel message needs to go hand in hand with those practical expressions of God's love. And that's what the letter of James was all about. You know, you tell me about your faith, I'll show you my faith by the way I live, by what I do. The expression of it. Sadly, as the gap has grown bigger, attitudes have tended to harden. I hear so often, if you're poor, it's your own fault. Well, clearly that isn't always true. Sometimes it is. Let's be realistic. Sometimes it is people's own fault. But you know what? I know that once my life was destined for hell. I can't blame anybody else. It was my own fault. It was my own sins that would have taken me there. And the same goes for every human being. Thankfully, God intervened even when I didn't deserve it. If God does that for me, should I and the church not do it for others? To him be the praise and the glory. Amen. Let's sing again now as we approach the Lord's table. I'm going to sing, "Beneath the cross of Jesus, I fain would take my stand. The shadow of a mighty rock within a weary land. A home within a wilderness, a rest upon the way. From the burning of the noontide heat and the burden of the day." Thank you. He it is who invites us. We have no right to come except in Jesus he invites us. And the invitation says, come. Come all those who are weary and heavy laden. Come not because you love the Lord enough, but because you want to love him more. Come not because any right of your own allows you to come. Come because you need mercy and help. Come because he first loved you and gave himself for you. Come to receive this token and pledge of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Paul gives an account of how this sacrament began. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. There's that principle, isn't it? Whatever we receive, whatever bounty we get from God, I pass it on to you. It's to be shared, not to be stored away for our own consumption. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. And he will come again. Let's pray. Father God, you have shared the inheritance of Jesus with us. You have shared his victory over death and the grave with us. We didn't deserve it. You share the bounty of your creation with us, and we're just stewards of it. You're the owner. You are a generous God, a God who cares, a God who provides more than enough. We ask for our daily bread, and you bless us with so much more. We enjoy enormous riches at your hand, and we want to say thank you. But we're very conscious that those riches are unevenly distributed. There is no justice in this world. Because of our greed, we grasp more than our fair share. We store up treasures in barns instead of storing up treasures in heaven. When Nehemiah called the people to celebrate the great festivals, it was to be a great feast time. And he said, those of you who have enough, look out for the people who have nothing with which to celebrate. Father, we want everybody to be able to celebrate this salvation in Jesus. We want people to be able to celebrate your gracious provision. We want people to know there is a God there who cares about them, who provides for them, that they don't need to worry. You will be there for them. Father, pour out your Spirit upon us now and upon these gifts of bread and wine. Set them apart and use them to speak of your eternal truth. Fill us with your Spirit, that we don't do these things out of compulsion because you make us We don't do it grudgingly because we have to, because people are watching. We do it because it's in our hearts, because we want to be generous, because it delights our hearts to see lives saved, lives turned around, lives provided for. Father, we pray for this church. May it be a beacon of light. Thank you for the work that goes on in the United Church here and in Christchurch, for the food bank, for the Citizens Advice Bureau, for the care and the compassion that is shown in this town. We know that there are many needs within this town, many people struggling with life. Empower them to bring your comfort, your hope, your light, to raise up young people to believe that you have a purpose for them and a plan for them, to restore the sense of community within this place, to make a church which is open to people from every social background. Father, we know what happens when we follow your ways, when we practice a true fast, not just for show, but coming and stemming from real love. Then your church will be known as the repairer of broken walls, the restorer of streets with dwellings. Then people will turn to your church. They will seek you, the God who is the head of this church, who set up this church. Father, we see the needs around the world, the failed crops in Eastern Africa, the war in Ukraine, the strife and distress, the refugees, the poverty, the people fleeing. People just slaving to eke out an existence, not knowing what it means to really live. Father, you have called us and set us apart to make a difference, to change this world. Empower us to do so. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Thank you. blood of Christ shed for the forgiveness of our sins. Lord, there is no more to be said this evening, but much to be done. Send us out from here with the fire of your love in our hearts, with the light of your hope in our eyes, with the power of your Holy Spirit to guide us, to strengthen us. Send us out to make a real difference in this place, to see lives turned around by the salvation of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's sing. I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. All who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save.
I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.